What would be your first thought if you saw the result of these two benchmarks compiled from the same exact source? Perhaps you'd expect the 10x difference to be due to optimization level, like 0 versus 0.3. Or perhaps you paid attention to the title or thumbnail, which hopefully suggests that the difference is actually with link time optimization. If all you want is the short version, then you just need to know that LTO enables optimization across translation units at the expense of more work at compile time. As long as that's acceptable, then you can typically enable LTO with compiler flags like FLTO, or for something like CMake, with properties related to interprocedural optimization. While there are plenty of details in how compilation works, the most important for this conversation is that concept of translation units. Roughly, we can think of this as a source file after it's been pre-processed, such as handling the includes, expanding macros, and so on. Each translation unit is then separately compiled and assembled, which may result in the optimizer having less context than you may have imagined. Let's take an example that I found useful for exploring multiple concepts, a one-dimensional kinematic example that you can picture as a simplification of a particle system. For something so simple, it's easy to envision the code starting as a single source file. Notably, we define a point structure, create a bunch of them in a vector, and roughly benchmark how long it takes to update all of them. The details of the update loop aren't particularly important yet, but we can see that it's not that complicated. A point's position is incremented by its velocity, multiplied by some constant delta time, and that velocity is conditionally reversed if it's outside of some range to simulate bouncing. This logic doesn't feel too complicated, and a benchmark with 2,000 points taking a quarter of a microsecond doesn't sound unreasonable. If we were to start to refactor, it should be fairly natural to extract some of the logic into an update method. From there, we can then create a separate source and header file for our point structure and compile it very similarly. Running the benchmark now, we encounter a familiar 10x performance difference, as we're up to about 2.5 microseconds. Taking this refactor code and compiling it with LTO, however, we're back in the ballpark of our single source benchmark. So why is there a difference, and why is it so substantial? A good way to answer this question is to look at the assembly generated in each of these scenarios. Using a profiler such as perf, we can observe that both the single source and LTO examples are able to inline the call to update, while the other example is not. This partly explains things, as we no longer have the overhead of a function call for every point, but digging into the update call itself highlights perhaps an even more important realization. Without the additional context of being inlined into a loop over all points, the compiler is unable to auto-vectorize the code. These optimizations are a topic of a previous video, but in short, under certain circumstances, the compiler can use vector instructions to process multiple pieces of data at once. Here, though, the optimizer doesn't have enough context to know that it can and should do so. As a result, the slow version is clearly using scalar instructions, denoted by the SS suffix, while the fast versions use packed vector instructions, denoted by the PS suffix. To verify our understanding of what's going on, it can be interesting to analyze what happens if we were to copy the code for update into our benchmark. With a manual inlining of sorts, what should happen if we compile and run the benchmark without LTO? Will this be enough context for the compiler to start generating packed vector instructions? Running the benchmark should give us fairly convincing evidence that it is, with a result roughly matching our previous fast examples. More concretely, we can again look at the results from perf, which clearly shows the instructions we were hoping for. While auto-vectorization makes for a dramatic example, there are all sorts of scenarios where additional context can help the optimizer do its job. This can be particularly impactful during hot loops as shown here, but it's worth noting that's not always the case. If we keep with the kinematic examples, we can see a much different story with a different approach to the same problem. This code happens to be better suited to taking advantage of auto-vectorization, but for now, the main concept to highlight is that our class is now also responsible for handling all the data for all the points. This means the update method should have enough details to make most optimizations regardless of whether LTO is enabled or not. We could verify this is the case with a profiler like before, but we can also switch things up and take a look at the binary statically with a tool like objdump. Looking at the benchmark compiled without LTO, it's clear that every iteration still needs to call our update method. Comparing this to the benchmark compiled with LTO, we find our helpful vector instructions are inlined. Where things differ from our previous examples, however, is in the update method itself, With the additional context available, the update method also is able to use similar vector instructions. While there is still overhead in calling update, running the benchmark shows that it's not much of an issue here. So should you use LTO when compiling your programs? The short answer is that you should at least give it a try. Much like with other optimizations, there's plenty of opportunity for it to help, and at worst, you have another data point on what works best for your project. If you like these examples, all the sources available on GitHub with a link in the description. If you want more videos like this, let me know in the comments and consider subscribing. There are plenty more topics that I'd love to dig into. Until next time, take care.